A big thank you to Skillshare for sponsoring today's video.
So we have a huge update on NASA's program to send astronauts back to the moon, namely the Artemis program. The science goals of the first mission to land astronauts back on the moon have been revealed, and they contain some really excellent information. Then the SLS core stage testing seems to face some delays. Quite the shocker, we know.
Still on the topic of Artemis, National Geographic wants to produce a series called Return to the Moon based on NASA's Artemis Moon program. Then let's also talk about the National Space Policy update and about Space Force's first official bases, ULA having finally managed to launch the NRO mission. And lastly, some interesting news on SpaceX's Starlink. A lot to talk about again, so stay tuned.
So on Monday, we talked about the quite smart strategy to announce the next astronauts to walk on the surface of the moon. And now we want to focus on the science goals of the Artemis missions, especially the Artemis 3 mission, which will be the first mission since Apollo 17 to return humans to the moon. NASA released a very long report in form of a PDF file with a relaxed 188 pages, link in the description. So we often talked about the long-term implications and the strategy behind the Artemis program, which ultimately aims to create a permanent human presence on the moon. We also often talked about the politics behind the Artemis program and how Jim Bridenstine had to walk the tightrope between the opposing sides in Congress and how successful he was in not only keeping the Artemis program alive, but actually reinvigorating the willpower at NASA to really make this mission happen. So let's recap the main science goals of the Artemis 3 mission and go through them one by one.
The first point is understanding planetary processes. Since the moon can be used as an analog for other airless worlds, such as asteroids, on the moon we can learn a lot about the history of the entire solar system. Understanding the character and origin of lunar polar volatiles. With lunar volatiles, water ice is meant, which is known to exist in the dark craters near the lunar south pole. That is why the Artemis 3 mission is expected to land near the lunar south pole. And building a moon base, of course, makes most sense at a location where there is water ice. So understanding the nature of this water ice, how much there is, and how to most easily extract it will be the most important goals for Artemis 3. Then the third point is interpreting the impact history of the Earth-Moon system. This means understanding if the Moon really formed from a giant impact of Earth with a Mars-sized object called Theia, when Earth was only about 100 million years old. This is called the giant impact theory. Or did the moon form separately? Or was it captured? Currently, the giant impact theory is the most accepted one, but it's not yet proven. The next point is revealing the record of the ancient sun and our astronomical environment. The moon has almost no atmosphere. Actually, it's called an exosphere because the whole of it weighs only 25 metric tons. That's how thin it is. So there's no erosion taking place on the moon, and meteorites billions of years old are perfectly conserved. This will teach us a lot about the history of our young sun and the solar system itself.
Then point five is observing the universe and the local space environment from a unique location. The far side of the moon would offer the perfect environment for optical and even better radio astronomy. Giant radio telescopes could be built there, completely shielded from Earth's radio noise, thus enabling crystal clear observations of very distant objects of the universe. The moon's lower gravity would actually enable us to build truly gigantic optical and radio telescopes, which would lead to enormous scientific discoveries. Point six is conducting experimental science in the lunar environment. This includes bringing back rock samples from the moon, as was done with the Apollo missions. But this will also include other science experiments, such as seismometers, laser interferometers, or drilling into the ground to extract deeper lying regolith. And then lastly, investigating and mitigating exploration risks. This basically means learning and practicing on the moon already to gain more experience of how to live on another world. While the Artemis 3 mission duration will probably not exceed 1 week of stay time on the moon tops, depending of course strongly on which lander will be chosen to conduct the mission, the later Artemis missions will foresee a much longer stay time. And the long-term goal is of course to build a permanently settled moon base with a constant rotation of astronauts working there in shifts, similar to how it is currently being done on the ISS. And if you want to support our YouTube channel and help us to continue talking about all kinds of disruptive technologies, then please check out our favorite online learning platform, Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community where millions of people come together to take the next step in their creative journey. With thousands of inspiring classes for creative and curious people on topics including programming, illustration, design, and so many more. On this channel, we often talk about artificial intelligence. And if you would like to learn more about AI and understand machine learning, we can highly recommend Christian Heilmann's course. He is senior developer at Microsoft, and in this course, he will teach you how machines are processing our data, finding patterns, and making our lives easier. The key lessons include machine learning myths, limitations, and capabilities. And with full self-driving around the corner, ethical considerations for everyone. And Christian explains it all in a really entertaining way.
The best value for money would be the annual subscription at less than $10 a month. And the first 1,000 people using our special link can even have a free trial of the Skillshare premium membership. So be sure to use our special link. Join Skillshare today and start to learn anything you like from home or anywhere you prefer.
But before we get the first humans to the surface of the moon with Artemis 3, we first have to even launch the Artemis 1 mission successfully. And NASA is indeed already preparing the unmanned Artemis 1 mission, which is currently set to launch in late November 2021. The solid rocket boosters of the Space Launch System are already being mounted, as we can see here. And NASA is trying to get the green run test of the SLS core stage underway. The green run test campaign consists of a wet dress rehearsal before we then have a full duration static fire test of the SLS core stages RS-25 engines. Now, a problem had been encountered, as Space News writes, models of how the liquid oxygen temperature would change as it was transferred through the test stand and into the tank didn't match what engineers saw, with temperatures about 2.2 degrees Celsius warmer than required for the test.
This increased temperature could lead to the creation of bubbles in the feed line to the core stage, which could in turn lead to more problems. So this issue has to be resolved now, which could result in additional delays. But the year 2021 is approaching fast, and the unmanned Artemis 1 mission is already scheduled to launch by the end of 2021. So there's not much more margin for delays. We hope the team at NASA will be able to get the problems under control. Because let's be clear here, even though we are not fans of SLS itself, we still want to see the Artemis missions succeed, of course. And what exactly is happening behind the scenes of NASA's Artemis Moon program will be the topic of a new show called Return to the Moon by National Geographic. The show will follow the Artemis astronauts all the way to the Artemis 3 mission. The showrunners plan to give viewers not only the details that lead to launch, but an insight into personal moments of the astronauts and their families. We don't have a date yet when this new show will start airing, but we guess that sometime around the Artemis 1 launch would be a good time to start.
Then, the NROL-44 satellite has finally been launched with the Delta IV Heavy. We remember that this mission faced many scrubs and was initially intended to launch more than 3 months ago. Now, finally, it did launch last Tuesday, the 10th of December. The NROL-44 is a classified satellite for the National Reconnaissance Office. The Delta IV Heavy will be retired in the course of the next years, making way for the new Vulcan Centaur. Well, that wasn't easy, talking about ULA without bashing them, that took quite some amount of willpower.
Now, finally, a bit more news on the Space Force again. Come on, it has to be. As if announcing the team of 18 Artemis astronauts last week, on December 9th, wasn't enough. Mike Pence also visited Cape Canaveral Air Force Base and announced that said Air Force Base and Patrick Air Force Base should henceforward be Space Force installations. However, as of now, this really only affects the naming of the installations. So don't get too excited yet about the first Space Force bases. Then, as if that wasn't enough, the president released a new national space policy on the very same day. So three space-related events of this administration in one day. The key points of this 40-page document, linked in the description, are as follows. Expanding the American commercial space sector, increasing international cooperation, continuing ambitious science and exploration activities, and bolstering national security and the United States leadership position in space. Scott Pace, Deputy Assistant to the President and Executive Secretary of the National Space Council, said on the same day that the fourth point is especially important. During that meeting, members of the NSC said that the United States' long-held space dominance has come under serious threat recently, primarily from China and Russia. For example, both nations are actively developing anti-satellite technology that could destroy or disable American satellites.
Now finally some news about Starlink again after all this time. SpaceX got $886 million worth of subsidies from the FCC in order to help provide 642,925 rural homes and businesses in 35 states with high-speed internet access. Starlink was one of the biggest winners in the FCC's Rural Digital Opportunity Fund. Starlink is currently still in beta with a planned release early next year. The pricing will be $99 per month with a one-time fee of $4.99 for the user terminal. Now, while this does sound expensive, please keep in mind that SpaceX is actually producing the Starlink terminals at a loss, as analysts estimate that they cost around $1,500 per piece to produce. The download speeds are in excess of 100 megabits per second, upload up to 40 megabits per second, and a delay time of ultra short 20 milliseconds. These are quite some impressive numbers. And some Native American tribes, for example, who struggled to have the luxury of getting high-speed internet, now can also finally have fast access to the internet thanks to Starlink.
But, Starlink is going to destroy the night sky forever. Some cry out. Really? How about the tens of thousands of pieces of large space debris and the 5,000 satellites already orbiting Earth? And the main idea behind Starlink is to help all people on this planet get fast internet access. Because for many people on Earth, this still seems an unachievable luxury. And it will also create insane amounts of revenue, helping to fund Starship and our interplanetary future. Elon Musk disrupting yet another area of technology, namely internet service providers. Some of these internet providers won't have a lot of fun in the 2020s, thanks to Starlink.
And we'll do another live stream on the 20th of December, so don't forget to subscribe and turn on the notification bell so that you get notified when we announce the exact time when we'll do the live stream.
We are looking forward to seeing you on the live stream and answering all your questions. So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and I would say, on to the future.
You will cut it or do we?
Yeah, of course.
Very good.
Lazy.
And what should I say?
So then, thanks for watching the JS Space Report. Yes, of course.
Yes, sir.
We are looking forward to answering all your questions and